welcome to Workflow from Home. We've been producing this mini-series in hopes to explore new tools and techniques that help professionals investigate and implement solutions for working remotely. My name is Michael, and I've been shooting these stories from my home. I didn't think that I'd turn my house into a studio, and I'm actually running out of areas to put my camera, and it's been raining a lot in California, so maybe the next episode we'll do outside if we get some sun. Anyway, thank you for the feedback on these episodes. I mean it. You're helping steer the direction that we go on based on the conversations that we're having. So please keep providing that feedback. And based on that feedback, in this episode, we're going to dive into one of the toughest parts of remote collaboration workflow. We're going to have an important discussion about real-time collaboration. Now, when it comes to how creative teams interact with each other, there's essentially two categories. The first is synchronous review. This is how we mostly see ourselves at work. We're all in the same building, we're the same room, talking to each other, physically interacting with each other, and collaborating in the same time and space with several key stakeholders. Directors particularly rely on synchronous review during edit sessions, VFX review, sound spotting sessions, or color correction sessions. Synchronous review is especially important in animation, where dozens of animators or lighters are touching the same character and need feedback from the director. Essentially, synchronous review is critical for the creative teams because it's the only way to keep a single vision on track where there might be hundreds of independent minds influencing the final product. The other type of collaboration is asynchronous review. This is what we've talked about in previous episodes. This is where collaborators can upload assets to the cloud from an NLE or effects tool or color corrector, so that stakeholders like a director or cinematographer or producer can comment from a remote location. Frame.io is an example of an asynchronous review tool, and it's where creatives have a chance to review material on their own time, make detailed notes, mark up the frame, and share their notes back to the collaboration team. But now we're in a world of remote review, but everyone still wants synchronous review. And it turns out there really isn't a clear standalone solution. The opportunity for an efficient remote synchronous review is to combine the ideas of synchronous review together with remote collaboration so that people can accomplish the collaborative process that they're used to having while being in a remote setting. But haven't we already done this before? Well, a common example has been deployed by top post-production facilities, and it's known as remote grading sessions. Remote grading sessions are extremely useful for a director or cinematographer, especially when they're shooting episodes of a series in one city and color correction of a previous episode is happening in another city. The technological challenge here is that you need to have a high-quality transmission, very little latency, a way to orally communicate, as well as two calibrated environments that are identical in display technology and calibration specifications. Basically, when this works, the tolerance between these two environments is virtually indistinguishable. And even though it's remote, the efficiency of a session might be greater than 90% as compared to an in-person session. But let's put a pin on that for a second. The reason remote review sessions are successful is because they are set up and maintained by the same post vendor with the same display technology in two different places. In other words, post houses are remoting to themselves from themselves. Most of the time, this is accomplished with several hardware devices, including the same display, same calibration practice, and a specialized hardware transmission appliance. But there's our problem. Post vendors can't come to our homes and set up appliances. So we don't have the necessary infrastructure in place for remote synchronous review today. Or do we? Well, let's outline the problem. We need to build a workflow in which the sender, an NLE or color corrector, can output real-time images from their computer. It needs to support a secondary external display. That's an important one. It often gets missed. It needs to display 24, 25, or 30 frames per second. It needs zero latency audio. It needs to be at least HD resolution. There needs to be a clear way to hear each other. It needs to be high enough quality to judge clear color images. It needs to support HDR. It needs to be encrypted, and there needs to be a trustworthy device on the receiving end to watch it. So how do we do that? Why does that seem so hard? Well, I have a theory. See, the problem is that the market for a high quality solution like the one we just outlined is actually really small. But all of a sudden, the need for the particular solution we talked about is relatively large. See, software solutions like Zoom or GoToMeeting or even Frame.io scale easily in accordance with increased demand. But a lot of the problem we just outlined lives in hardware. Monitors, calibration, encoding, none of these can really be easily downloaded, and therefore it's harder to rapidly scale them across more users. Or can they? Well, the first thing to point out is that even though the market is small, there are some remote synchronous collaboration tools out there, but each one has different variables that you need to research. Premium tools such as SohoNet ClearView, or TVIPs or Streambox are great hardware appliance technology options that you should explore. But people are asking us about low-cost alternatives that are easy to scale and easy to set up by yourself and avoid hardware appliances and allow creatives to collaborate with no trade-offs. Well, one of the community groups that's reached out to me the most about this are colorists and cinematographers. So I want to specifically talk to you. How can a colorist set up a remote synchronous live session with a DP from their home? It has to be high quality. We're judging DI after all. It can't leverage a dedicated encoding hardware appliance. In other words, we need a software solution and we need it yesterday. So let's create a use case in which this would be necessary. Let's say we have a 1-hour network episodic series with 10 episodes that needs to go through DI. The series was shot on the Alexa Mini using 3.2K ProRes XQ files captured in Log C. We have a colorist working from home with a Resolve 16 studio setup, and we have a DP that wants to collaborate on a remote synchronous review session from their home. So how do we do that? Well, back in episode 2, when we discussed air-gapped editing, we talked about the importance of getting the original camera file sources into Frame.io. This is now an imperative part of the process for a software-based synchronous review session. So it's likely that the post facility has already put the ARRI RAW OCF or original camera files up in the cloud and got them already in Frame.io, so it's completely central to everyone. Next, once the editor does a turnover for the DI and mastering, the conformist takes the XML or EDL, loads it into the new Frame.io transferring tool, and then pulls down the ProRes 3.2K files used in the cut. The good news is that the Frame.io transferring tool will only download what's in the list. The bad news is that ProRes 3.2K is high quality. It's a large file. In a facility, this isn't really a big deal, but you're at home and you need to make sure that you are prepared for this session. My internet bandwidth peaks at 400 megabits per second. But what does that mean? Well, you can use this formula to determine the best path forward. Take your source file and then figure out its data rate in megabits per second, which in the case of ProRes XQ 3.2K is 1200, divided by 8, which gives us megabytes per second. So let's round that up to 160. We multiply that by 60 seconds per minute, and then multiply that by 60 minutes per hour, and then divide that by 1000 since there are 1000 megabytes in a gigabyte. The result tells us that ProRes XQ 3.2K is about 575 gigabytes per hour. Then we use the same formula and use it to calculate our bandwidth. As I mentioned, my network download performance is about 400 megabits per second. I divide by megabytes, multiply by seconds, then minutes, and then make change by gigs, and then I learn that my network can download about 180 gigabytes per hour. This means that a sustained 400 megabit network can download 1 hour of ProRes XQ 3.2K in about 3 hours. Since a pull list for a 1 hour episodic conform is going to include at least 2 hours of total media, this is doable, but an overnight task. Obviously, slower networks will require more time and storage. My guess is you have neither. So what do we do in that situation? Well, there's a powerful trick hidden in the Frame.io transferring tool that can make this workflow really easy. Let's say the cinematographer does not have access to a high-speed download network or the ability to store terabytes of data or playback large, high-quality files. Well, just prior to initiating the download in the transferring tool from the Frame.io cloud, you can select proxy instead of the default source. See, when Frame.io uploaded the ProRes XQ 3.2K log C files, it automatically transcoded an AVC version of the original file for web optimization. This file, of course, is not as good as the original, but it matches the file name, the time code, the resolution, the aspect ratio, the log encoding, and the color space. Frame.io simply makes it available to you as a valuable asset. And a high quality source like a ProRes XQ file from an Alexa camera will compress beautifully into a log AVC file. What that means is that Frame.io created a 10 megabit log encoded AVC still in 3.2K, and instead of being 575 gigabytes per hour, this file is more like 5 gigabytes per hour. So with this Frame.io tool, a DP can automatically download the entire episode of Selects through the Frame.io transfer tool in high quality in less than an hour even on a below average network. In fact, even the colorist could download the AVC files first and start the process using proxies while the source OCF files download in the background. In either case, we now have a media foundation for a powerful workflow for colorists who use Resolve that's already built into the tool, Resolve Remote Color. This is a function in which multiple people can sit on a color session in different places, but with real-time results. And the beauty here is there's no specialty hardware or video streaming. This is really one of the only setups of its kind, and it's very elegant. To set this up, you'll need to have a colorist using Resolve Studio who acts as the host, and a cinematographer who has also Resolve Studio and acts as the client. There's a little setup required, but it's relatively simple, and we've made a setup reference guide that you can download from the Frame.io website. This will help you get through the setup procedures, but I'll explain the key elements here. First, the editor uploads turnover lists to a Frame.io directory, so there's a centralized place to manage all the list exchanges. Once that's received by the conformist or colorist, the EDL is uploaded into the Frame.io transferring tool where all the selected source files are downloaded. Again, in our case, this is Alexa 3.2K ProRes XQ. At the same time, the cinematographer logs into Frame.io and downloads the same list to be used in the Frame.io transferring tool, but initiates the downloading of the proxy files. This takes less than an hour and can play back without issue on a laptop hard drive. After the conform and resolve, the colorist uploads a DaVinci Resolve project into the Frame.io mainframe, which is also known as a DRP file. This is then downloaded by the cinematographer. A cinematographer can simply drag and drop the downloaded video assets into Resolve, open the DRP, and now we have two Resolves with identical media and an identical conform. But remember, the trick here is that the colorist has full quality log files on a RAID and the client has proxy files on an internal hard drive. Now we go to the remote color menu and we select remote grading. In order to make this work, we have to securely connect two computers together. Now there's a couple ways to do this. One is using a virtual private network or VPN. The other is using what is known as port forwarding. For groups that have strong IT support and stronger security protocols, we recommend getting help to set up a VPN for the colorist and the client to share their computers. If you're doing this yourself, however, it's a lot simpler to try port forwarding. With port forwarding, Resolve talks to the remote colorist's network, which then gets directed to the colorist's computer. The remote colorist sets up this forwarding rule in their router, but every router is different, so you may have to refer to your router's documentation on how to do this. So how secure is this? Well, since Resolve is listening to one port, only one setup at a time can be accessed through a network like this. A security breach would have to sniff your IP address, they'd have to know what port your service is on, and they'd have to expose your computer through the Resolve service on that port. Since Resolve allows you to accept or reject access when the port is opened, this minimizes the chances of that ever happening. Other safeguards, such as a firewall, could easily be implemented to make sure the traffic is only going where it's supposed to. This will still use your public IP address, but it makes sure that other traffic that tries to talk with your computer never has the chance. So let's try it. Well, today I'm working with colorist Nick LaRoe, who has been working from home in Vermont. After Nick has sent me his port forwarded IP address, I can type it into Resolve's remote color prompt, select connect, and Nick has the chance to grant me access. From here, we have a high fidelity, audio enabled, software based grading session going at the same time. Remember, because we have media on both ends of the pipe, there's no screen sharing. So the data being transmitted through the network isn't video. It's play and stop and grading commands, which are ultra low data exchanges. This is very similar to how online gaming works, actually. This can be done on a Mac or a Windows, and most importantly, it can even use an external display and watch the colorist work in real time. Nick and I communicate using any type of an online chat system, and then we can take advantage of the benefits of synchronous review, much like working in a facility together. Nick is driving the session and able to view on his calibrated Sony OLED display. As a client, I'm using an Apple XDR monitor, which I've set up in a dark room. I can see every adjustment Nick makes, including the actual color controls, keying, use of secondaries, and custom LUTs. And most notably, Nick is working with the source files on a direct attached RAID, and I'm able to see the same results with proxies running off my laptop. If a director or cinematographer doesn't have a Sony BVM or Apple XDR, many of us now have 4K HDR televisions that use OLED or LED or quantum dot technology. There's lots of resources out there on how to calibrate each of these tools, so check them out. I personally own a 55-inch LG C9. What's more, if I need to do remote grading for an HDR or Dolby Vision session, Nick and I can set up our Resolve session as a Dolby Vision or HDR 10 Plus session. I feed a Thunderbolt 3 cable out of my laptop into a Blackmagic Ultra Studio 4K Mini and connect that to my LG. And now I'm looking at a calibrated 700 nit HDR output in real time where the color is 3,000 miles away. Because you can upload just about any file into Frame.io, if it's an RGB file like a ProRes or MXF, Frame.io will give you an automatic transcode to share. And because you can just load about anything into a Resolve timeline, you can use this same technique for VFX reviews or edit reviews or even final QC or screenings. In all the articles that I've read and all the interviews that I've done and all the correspondences I've had since starting this series, there are two things that I've discovered that are really interesting and keep coming back to me. First, the individuals and the companies that have a history of being willing to think out of the box are the ones that deployed the most efficient work from home solutions in virtually no time. Some of these groups that we're talking to migrated their entire company and their entire pipelines to work from home in as little as one day. And second, just because we're all deploying remote workflows doesn't necessarily mean that we have to make qualitative or fluid compromises. In other words, if you find yourself in a situation where the work from home isn't flowing, question it. A good portion of the future of all commerce, let alone the media and entertainment industry, is going to remain virtual. If the history of cinema technology and toolset transitions has taught us anything, it's that we like to keep things the way they are. Some of you think that we're setting up remote work and it's going to be like a camping trip, when in actuality, this is going to be an entirely new foundation. Why go back to normal when normal wasn't really working that well? So try these techniques, build on top of them, provide feedback to manufacturers, question these ideas, share your ideas, and most of all, come at change with an open mind. This is the perfect time for us all to clear the deck and work together and try to form some new habits.